So they do repress. Is that what you're saying? You slid on the piece of paper. Did you slide it under Jimmy's door last night?
What's that?
John was saying he was going to slide requests up under your door. I said, did you do that?
Is my song ready yet?
Yes, my song.
Wait, it's all up to Anshu. I'm a company.
The song is cooking.
Anshu is song.
It's in the pan.
Is it done yet?
And let there be praises to the Almighty, King of creation, Ancient of
Mr. Dean was asking me a couple questions yesterday about it, like when it got started and why it got started and what our objectives are and stuff like that. And for me, I think it started with about 6 or 7 weeks from graduation in the academy. I was outside with Mike and my dad and Uncle Jack, and we were shoveling mulch. And Uncle Jack stopped and looked at me, and he said that he saw me in a dry and weary place. And he started talking to me about trees, and he said that relative to a lot of trees, weeping willows have a root system that digs down really deep. And that weeping in the Word of God is a sign of brokenness, and that digging your roots down deep and being broken before God is how you get back to the Lord. And I just kind of stopped in my tracks and looked at Uncle Jack. I didn't really know what to say. And I don't know how you knew that, Uncle Jack, because I didn't yet. And about four weeks later, I was coming down Grover Road toward logistics with about 3 weeks left in the academy. And I really felt like the Lord was telling me that it was, you know, trees aren't designed to be able to pull up their roots and run to an oasis. They're designed to learn how to survive where they are. And I think that the Lord was telling me to learn how to survive where I was. So I was out of the academy, and I was in that dry and weary place, and I kind of noticed that a lot of my buddies, Will DiCarlo, and my brother, and John Smart, and Andrew Grant, were in the same boat. And above everything else, I was tired of making the same mistakes in my life, and the shame and the guilt that comes with it. And Uncle Jack mentioned the sin that so easily besets us yesterday, and there's sin in my life and all of our lives that easily besets us, and I was tired of letting that get between me and God. So I sat with my father and with Mike and Uncle Jack and one of my good friends, and I looked for advice. And I think God showed me Romans 7:18. I know he did, because it was read last night, and I didn't know it was going to be. Mr. Ron read it, and it's from the Apostle Paul. And I know if Paul says this, then I can definitely agree with it. He says, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, nothing good dwells, for the will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find." And I know Paul didn't find it, and I'm not going to, but I was tired of looking at myself and trying to use willpower to get over these obstacles between me and God, and me and four other guys were in the same place, so we decided to do something about it. And all of us were in the same boat in that we had a lot of good, solid Christian leadership in our lives. And me and Jeff had said it before a few times, that between Uncle Jack and my father and Mike and just all the men in the church, I was always hard-pressed to find people who weren't going to lead me in the ways of God. And because of that, it's kind of been ingrained in me to almost, I just kind of expect something more for myself than to sit in a seat the rest of my life. And I was just tired. I was tired of being stuck in a rut, and I wanted to do something for God and pay back what had been invested in me so much. So it was five like-minded guys just growing together and trying to build each other up. And Mr. Dean wanted me to try to tie this into persevering for the sake of others, but the scripture verse that came up in the last meeting, and one that God has really been pressing in my heart, is 1 Timothy 4:16, which says, "Take heed to yourself and to the doctrine, continue in them, for in doing this you will save both yourself and those who hear you." And Mike was talking about making sure that, you know, the next couple of generations are secure. So another reason for doing what we're doing isn't even for ourselves anymore. And, you know, then you got to look at after that scripture, well, if we do sit on our butts and we're just seed fillers for the rest of our life, well, then, you know, we can be accountable for other people who aren't built up in the Lord. So we kind of coined the name PACT, P-A-C-T, which stands for putting away childish things, which is what we're trying to do, because it's just time to grow up. So in closing, there's three objectives we have. Number one is glorify God and give back what has been invested. You know, when we take our final breath and we stand before God, I want to hear, I want to see everything that he's poured into me, and I want to hear him say, "Well done," and that he saw a return on the investment he made in me. It would be such an honor. And number two is to make him proud. One of the biggest things for me with being a firefighter and getting out of the academy was knowing that, I mean, I knew my father was always proud of me, and he'd have been proud of me no matter what I was doing. But being a firefighter, I knew that I was making my dad proud. And so much more than that, you know, I want to make the Lord proud. And we pray it all the time in our meetings, that we want to hear, we want to feel God just look down and be proud of what's going on in this meeting and in what we're doing with the relationships that he's allowed us to have. And the third third thing is to protect myself and my brothers from evil. Jabez did not pray to conquer evil. He prayed that God would keep it from him. And one thing that God's really been pressing on my heart is to not pray for the strength to fight evil, but the wisdom to avoid the temptation altogether. So if you guys could, that would certainly mean everything to me and to the rest of us, that you would pray for us and ask that God continue to meet us, because he is absolutely doing something in all of our lives, and it's doing no small part to the examples that he's put in our lives. So thank you very much. Amen.
Kind of put a challenge in my heart here to throw out to us. If you're talking to me, I've got two ears that I have to listen to what I say too. And it's not to become part of Ryan's meeting. It's not to duplicate Ryan's meeting and these young men, but it's to pick up the banner and consider, is God calling me to a higher place? Not for my sake, but for others. And that's what I hear in this young man's voice. That it started for himself, but God is turning it. That he's looking back and saying, there's others that I'm responsible for. It's a very mature place to be. So, thank you. I thank you for Mike. I thank you that you are a faithful God, that you meet him right where he is. Father, I pray right now you will still that beating heart. Just have it calm down. Father, I pray for his mind, that he may just be at rest in his mind and can be just washed clean to separate that which would distract and that which you would have him share. I pray, Lord, you would use him out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. And Father, we know you are abundantly in our brother's heart. And we pray that he speak your truth and your words in Jesus' name.
Before I start, I just want to say something about Ryan and Pastor Jack's shed. Pastor Jack's got two sheds, one with tools, and you're bringing the other tools to the other shed. You know, yourselves, the Bible, and the Holy Spirit. So,
very good. Yeah.
God bless them. how many, first off, give me a volleyball. I'm really comfortable. Not so comfortable. These are good for high, you're shaking knees. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I was told, asked last night to give a 5-minute testimony because I accepted because I believe the Lord has really been speaking to me lately. And, how many people have ever felt like the Lord has been, ever nudged you in a certain direction? I feel like he really gave me a push this weekend, you know, not just a nudge. I hang out with Steve Carrier a lot, and that man's an inspiration to me. He really is. And he has memorized the whole book of James, and that really convicted me. And so I said, okay, let's see what this. I mean, I've read James before. So I read the book of James and started going over, and I was like, you know, I really need to start memorizing the book of James. I didn't even get past the first chapter and realized this is really speaking to me. And then, let's everybody turn to James 1, if you would, please. About 2 weeks ago is when I decided that I was going to start memorizing the book of James, but it actually took me a week and a half to actually begin to do that. Started doing it, and I'm getting very blessed by it. But I didn't realize when I said I was going to come on the men's retreat that it was going to be talking about perseverance for the sake of others. And it's really funny how God works things together. Because what I'm about to read to you in the first chapter of James, just 2 through 8 or something like that, or 9, I think really talks on what we've been talking about this weekend and what God has been It says, consider it all joy, my brothers, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, or another version says perseverance. And let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. But if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives it to all men generously without reproach, and it will be given to him. I'll stop there. 12. Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. So I found it kind of funny, or not funny, but that God was leading me to memorize James, and the first thing I read in James is perseverance and endurance, and then we come on as men for treat, and that's all we're talking about is perseverance and endurance. I struggle with that in my life. I think, Dean, earlier this conference or meeting retreat, I was talking about you can have, what do you say? Back of my Bible, because it says God's not looking for ability, but he's looking for availability. And God's given me many giftings and talents in certain areas, and I even have the availability, but it's the perseverance, it's the long-suffering, it's the endurance that I struggle with. And I've gone to many, many men's retreats. I think I've gone to almost every single one that since I've been here. We started in church in 97, what'd you say? We started here in 97. I've heard a lot of good messages, but I've really had nothing that has really touched my heart like this weekend has. And it's really spoke to me like this weekend has. We can have all the good intentions in the world, but if we don't act those out and we don't do those things, if we stop today and go home and forget about it and go into our daily lives, what good did this weekend do? It didn't do anything. I think Ryan was saying he was tired of wasting. I was telling Mark in our little small group yesterday, I feel like Moses. You know, walking in the desert for 40 years, I feel like I've wasted my life. I've given a lot of good things, but I'm not where God wants me to be. God has a purpose and a plan for each and every one of us.
Yeah.
If we're not walking in that purpose and that plan, what good is it? We're not in His will. We're not in His will. I'm sick and tired of not being in God's will. And if many of you don't know, I struggle with bipolar. And I was diagnosed with that about 5 years ago, but I think I've had it since I was 18. Fall into depression a lot of times and missed a lot of work. Like, I'm talking a lot of work, like 3 months, 4 months, a year. I've really been struggling with trying to correct that. And but it's not through me, it's through Him. And but God has really helped me this year with that. I'm trying to change my life around this year. And you can't do it by yourself. Pastor Jack said you can't be a bone on your own. And you definitely can't do it without the Word of God. You need the Word of God in your life. And you need friends who are Christians that are in your life that can uplift you and be encouragements to you. And Ryan was talking about how Dean wanted us to tie in the perseverance for the sake of others into what we talked about today. And really, if you think about it, if you're persevering in the gifts and the talents that God has given you, you're going to be doing that for the sake of others, because God gave you those gifts and He gave you those.